Hello. So this short film is about the period in Russian history after the Bolshevik Revolution in October 1917. And I'm going to talk about the period while Lenin was alive, i.e., up until 1924. There's three big things to look at, really. The first is about Lenin's and the Bolsheviks' exercise of political power and how they held on to political power, and in fact, established political control of all of Russia. The second thing is about the Bolsheviks' control of the economy and how they managed to do that and how successful they were. And the third thing is about the impact of Bolshevism, of communism, on Russian society. First of all, I'm going to talk about the political stuff. In fact, the political and the economic stuff is kind of interwoven and interdependent. So I'm going to talk about the political and the economic stuff together. Now, in theory, after the October Revolution, Lenin claimed that the new government, which I think I mentioned in the last film, called the Sovnarkom, the Soviet of People's Commissars, Soviet Narod Commissars, the Council of People's Commissars, kind of like a cabinet of ministers. In theory, Lenin claimed that that government represented the ordinary workers and peasants and soldiers and sailors in Russia through the Soviets, the councils that had sprung up all over the country. But the reality was that Sovnarkom was just kind of a clique, a wing of the Bolshevik Party, a group of Bolsheviks that had seized power in October 1917 and just decided to set themselves up as a government. And this is illustrated clearly by the elections that went ahead in November 1917. All throughout the duration of the life of the provisional government, they had said that there would be elections to this parliament called a constituent assembly. And those elections actually went ahead in November 1917. When the results came out, Lenin didn't get the results that confirmed the Bolsheviks as the most popular majority party in Russia. In fact, the Bolsheviks only won about a quarter of the vote, about 24% of the vote in the elections. By far the biggest party were the Socialist Revolutionary Party, the party that claimed to represent the peasants and as you can tell by the name, were also socialists. So this put Lenin in a difficult position. He'd claimed power on behalf of the Soviets and on behalf of the people, but the elections had gone ahead, and something like 40 million people voted in those elections. Elections had gone ahead, and they hadn't produced a majority showing that the Bolsheviks were the most popular party. So what did he do? Well, he sent along Red Guards to the opening of the Constituent Assembly and shut it down by force. Now, you may well think, with some justification, that this was the first act of a ruthless dictator who was determined to do whatever it took to hold on to power. Lenin justified what he was doing as saying there was no need for a constituent assembly because the people were already represented by the Soviets and by the Bolshevik government. And anyway, he said that a constituent assembly was a kind of a bourgeois form of democracy, and it wasn't the kind of democracy that could truly represent the people. This is how he justified himself. Now, what else politically? At the same time, over the first, because well, I was just talking about the period October to December 1917, also in terms of the economy, in those few months, Lenin realized that the economically Russia wasn't ready yet for the transition to a full-on socialist economy. So he decided as a temporary measure on what he called state capitalism. And what that basically meant was that the state would retain control of the large industries and of what he called the commanding heights of the economy, but that there would need to be cooperation with what he called bourgeois specialists, people who'd been involved in running the economy before the revolution. However, he and his government passed a couple of quite important decrees in early November 1917. One was called the Decree on Workers' Control, which, as you can probably tell by the title, gave workers control over the factories that they worked in. And another was called the Decree on Land, which gave the peasants control over the land that they farmed. Now, both of these, although they seem to represent giving power to the people, and Lenin could claim that that was what his Bolshevik government were doing, both of them really, all they really did was reflect the reality of what had already happened. Workers had already taken over their factories. Peasants had already taken over the land. So the Bolsheviks weren't really doing anything that new here. However, they did set up a new organization called the Vyshenka. The Vyshenka, which was the Supreme Council on the National Economy. And the Vyshenka saw it as its responsibility to nationalize, i.e. take state control of the most important elements of the country's economy, i.e. the banks and the railways and the large industries. Now, unsurprisingly, given the way the Bolsheviks acted, given that they took power and even they hadn't won power democratically, there was a lot of opposition to them. And that opposition came to a head in the summer of 1918 when a civil war broke out. Hang on, what I should say before we get onto the civil war, another major reason why there was such opposition to the Bolsheviks was that Lenin had promised peace, he promised to get Russia out of war, and by March 1918 he had negotiated a peace deal with Germany. He sent Trotsky off to deal with the Germans, and Trotsky made a bit of a hash of it. That's a long other story we can go into another time. And then he went along to the negotiations with the Germans himself. And it culminated in the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk. This treaty enabled Russia to withdraw from the First World War, but at enormous cost. Russia had to give up a huge amount of territory. And it was incredibly valuable territory as well. Huge part of the Ukraine, which was a very fertile part of the Russian Empire that had produced a lot of the food of the Russian Empire. And it had to give up territory, a lot of industrial territory. And so this giving up of territory and of people and of resources caused a huge amount of resentment towards the Bolsheviks, who in many people's eyes had just seized power illegitimately. So, as I was saying a minute ago, all this opposition to the Bolsheviks culminated in the outbreak of a civil war in the summer of 1918. Now, the civil war then lasted for 3 years and basically was between the Bolsheviks, who became known as the Reds on one side, and the opposition, who are basically anyone against the Bolsheviks, called the Whites, and sometimes you hear about the Greens being involved, peasant armies, on the other side. Now, the Whites were a kind of a disparate collection of groups and people. There were people that wanted the Tsar back, there were nationalists, there were right-wingers, there were moderate socialist groups who disapproved of the way the Bolsheviks had taken power, people like the socialist revolutionaries. And it was this disparate nature of the white armies that was to prove to be one of their main, in fact, fatal weaknesses. Because they were made up of so many different groups with different ideas and different visions for what Russia could become, they lacked unity. And that was one of the key, and they lacked unity of purpose and unity of leadership. And these were key reasons why the Reds were able to defeat them in the Civil War. The Bolsheviks also had some key things in their favor. For a start, they controlled the main cities, Moscow and St. Petersburg, and they controlled the main industrial areas of the country as well. And they managed to maintain control of the railways, which was really important for moving troops around. They also, in Leon Trotsky, who was appointed Commissar for War in 1918, they also had a very driven and determined and capable leadership. And many the sources show that it was Trotsky's leadership that was really important in the Bolsheviks winning the Civil War. It also didn't help the Whites that they were helped by foreign troops, foreign armies. Britain sent troops and ships, so did America, so did Japan, so did France. They all sent assistance to the so-called white armies. And this enabled the Bolsheviks, the Reds, to paint themselves as the true kind of nationalist saviors of Russia, who weren't dependent on foreign assistance. I'm not going to talk at great length about the Civil War. I think, you know, I've given you a sense of the main weaknesses of the Whites and strengths of the Reds. And suffice to say that by 1921, those things had enabled the Bolsheviks to win the Civil War. The Bolsheviks, during the Civil War in 1919, changed their name to the Communist Party. And at the end of the Civil War, Russia, which had become known as the Russian Federated Socialist Republic in 1918, had now turned into the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, the USSR. It was officially called that by 1922, when it's shortened in the West to the Soviet Union. So this is the point, or this is the period at which Russia changes from being the old Russian Empire and becomes the new Soviet Empire, the USSR. Now, in terms of political control, one of the key instruments that enabled the Bolsheviks to impose their power on the country was the formation of the secret police. And this was known as the Cheka. The Cheka was formed in December 1917, and its purpose was to destroy a counter-revolution and sabotage. It was headed by a man called Felix Dzerzhinsky, and he and his organization were incredibly ruthless in rooting out and suppressing and executing anyone they felt who was going to pose a major threat or even a substantial threat to the new Bolshevik government, including the old royal family, who infamously were all shot, murdered in July 1918. As well as the royal family, the Cheka also set about ruthlessly persecuting the church and members of the church, the clergy. Church property was confiscated, clergy were arrested, imprisoned, exiled, executed in some places. As Marx had said, religion was the opium of the people, and in the new Bolshevik society, there wasn't to be any need for the church, and so it was ruthlessly persecuted by the Bolsheviks. Economically, during the Civil War, Lenin felt that state capitalism, the bundle of measures that he'd put in place to manage the economy after the seizure of power, wasn't going to be sufficient to keep the economy running during the Civil War. And his primary concern was ensuring a steady supply of food production. So he brought in a new economic policy in 1918 called war communism. War communism was basically, fundamentally, the most important part of it was making sure that the state could get enough food from the peasants to feed the towns and cities and the Red Armies. And it was to be bought, and that was to be achieved by the physical requisitioning, i.e. taking from the peasants of their food, regardless of whether it left them with enough. There was also a decree on nationalisation in the summer of 1918, and this decree said that all major industries should be brought under state control. But the main feature, the most infamous feature of war communism, as I've said, was the requisitioning of food from the peasants. And in particular, a particular feature of this was the demonisation of a class of peasants who were labelled the kulaks. Kulaks were a kind of slightly more prosperous, or so-called kulaks, were a slightly more prosperous group of the peasants who were probably the more efficient farmers or the more entrepreneurial farmers, the farmers who'd taken advantage of the Stolypin reforms, for example, in the early part of the 20th century. But Lenin and the Bolsheviks accused them of being responsible for the country's food shortage. He said that they were hoarding grain, and it was because of them that the country didn't have enough food. So there was a lot of propaganda was brought out to demonize the kulaks as a class. And in fact, lots of them were arrested, and some were executed as an example to others. And peasants were encouraged to rat on their neighbours and to accuse them of being kulaks and of undermining the cause, undermining the state. Another very unpleasant aspect of war communism was that in the face of having their food taken off them, the peasants decided, a lot of peasants decided, to just not cooperate with the government at all and to stop producing food, or to only produce enough for themselves. But even that food that they produced for themselves was taken from them by requisition squads. So the effect of this was that millions of peasants were left with enough food, with not enough food to live on. And by 1921, a famine had broken out. And in fact, it's said that during the Civil War, about 10 million people in Russia are said to have died, and about half of those died because of famine, because the food was forcibly taken from the peasants. By 1921, the whites had been beaten, and the Bolsheviks had managed to win the Civil War, but there was still a lot of discontent in the country. And it wasn't just discontent from the Bolsheviks' political opponents, there was also discontent within his own party. There was discontent within the Bolsheviks about the way the peasants were being so brutally treated. And in fact, there was a rebellion, there was a faction formed within the Bolshevik party called the Workers' Opposition. And the most high profile female member of the Bolshevik party, a woman called Alexandra Kollontai, was closely associated with this group, the Workers' Opposition. And there was growing opposition amongst the ranks in the army and in the navy as well. Notably, in March of 1921, a rebellion broke out on the Kronstadt Island naval base. The Kronstadt Island is a small island where there's a naval base just outside of St. Petersburg, or on the edge of St. Petersburg. And there was a rebellion against the Bolshevik government launched from that naval base. Trotsky, who was Commissar for War, dispatched or ordered the military that was still loyal to the Bolsheviks to deal with this rebellion, and the rebellion was brutally crushed. But it was a crushing of people who previously had been very supportive of the Bolsheviks. In fact, it was the sailors based at Kronstadt that played a key role in the taking of St. Petersburg during the October Revolution of 1917. Lenin said that the Kronstadt Revolution, quote, was the lightning flash that lit up reality. He said it made him realize that he had to change course or soften the course of his government's policies in order to survive. And so in 1921, he introduced a new economic policy, wiping away the old economic policy of war communism. And this new economic policy was called the New Economic Policy, or NEP. And the main purpose of this was to incentivize the peasants to produce more food. War communism had been the stick, NEP was going to be the carrot. So instead of having their food requisitioned from them by force, peasants were asked to pay a tax, and they were allowed to sell any surplus food they made on the open market. And the open market, private markets, were legalized. Small businesses were legalized. But the state was to retain control of what Lenin called the commanding heights of the economy, the banks, the major industries, the railways, that kind of thing. Now, this caused a big kind of political problem within the Bolshevik Party, because they were communists. You know, they hadn't brought about a communist revolution in order to let the peasants trade on open markets, to in order to let the peasants have their bit of capitalism and for small businesses to set up and for people to enrich themselves. That wasn't, you know, what was the point in having a communist revolution if that's what you were going to do? So it caused quite a lot of strains within the Bolshevik Party, quite a lot of arguments, which Lenin dealt with in 1921 by bringing in a ban on any factions in the party. And basically saying, listen, if you're in the Bolshevik Party, you have to go along with the leadership. And he, you know, and it kind of technically made the party a lot more kind of authoritarian and dictatorial, which again was not popular with all members of the party. But Lenin felt it was a necessity, just as he felt his new economic policy was a necessity. And the fact is that by 1922, 23, and 24, when Lenin died, the economy did improve. But it left a problem for the leaders of the party after Lenin as to what to do about the new economic policy, because whilst the economy might have improved, it certainly wasn't communism, or not communism as many in the party envisaged it. And it was one of the major things that Lenin's successors argued about and struggled over in the struggle for power after his death. But I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Finally, the third thing that I'm going to talk about, Lenin's Russia, was the impact of Leninism, Bolshevism on society. There was a kind of a distinct and deliberate objective of trying to create a kind of new Soviet man in the Soviet Union. That this was mankind kind of evolving onto into a new phase of humanity. Marx had said that communism was the perfect end of history, and so it required a new kind of humanity to, you know, or a new kind of humanity went hand in hand with that. So the state, the new government, advocated culture that reflected these kind of socialist ideals. They advocated art and music and film and you know, all kinds of art forms that was positive about working class culture. Any kind of cultural work had to express socialist ideas. The church, as I mentioned earlier, was demonized. It was disestablished. The link between church and state was cut. Religious teaching in schools was abolished. Members of the clergy were imprisoned or exiled or executed, and all cultural work was supposed to advocate socialist ideas. Similarly, for women were encouraged to liberate themselves from the old bourgeois capitalistic bonds of family and of marriage. Marriage was seen as ownership and enslavement by men. Family was seen as an imprisoning for women. Women's traditional roles of bringing up, nurturing children were seen as restrictions on them. These were ideas that Alexandra Kollontai, who I mentioned earlier, was very keen on promoting. So the government brought in things that kind of enabled these kinds of objectives, like making divorce easier, making abortion easier, saying it was the state's responsibility to bring up children, that there would be large boarding schools that would bring up children, and that it was the responsibility of society to bring up children rather than the small family unit. The whole idea was to try and kind of undermine the family. However, how successful any of these kind of social measures were is hugely debatable, because religion, family, sexual, gender roles, all of these things are deeply entrenched kind of traditions in lots of societies, and especially in a conservative society like Russia. And so, whilst that these might have been officially the ideals that the government was promoting or official government policy, the real impact of them is really debatable. In the last couple of years of Lenin's life, he suffered a series of strokes and his health seriously declined. And in 1922, 23, 24, it became obvious that the Bolshevik Party was going to have to deal with the questions of Lenin's legacy. Who was going to lead the country after he died? What should be done about the new economic policy? What should be done about promoting revolution all around the world, which had been Lenin's original conception of the Bolshevik Revolution, that it would set off revolutions everywhere? All of these questions were basically left unanswered at the time of Lenin's death. He did write a document in 1922 in which he criticized most of his colleagues and indicated that he didn't really think any of them would be suitable to take over leadership of the country. But he saved his strongest criticism for Stalin, who, as general secretary of the party, he said had built up too much power, was not to be trusted. And after he'd called Lenin's wife Krupskaya a whore, he said Lenin was too rude. He said Stalin was too rude to take power. However, he was also very critical of Trotsky. He said that Trotsky was too vain and too arrogant and unpopular. And so he didn't make it clear who should take over after him. What does seem quite clear that when Lenin died in 1924, what had he left behind? He left behind a very authoritarian government, an absolutist government, a government where obedience to the ultimate leader was crucial. He'd left behind quite a dictatorial government. It also left behind quite a bureaucratic government. He'd also arguably created a police state. The Cheka had become immensely powerful and pervasive in Russia, and arguably had created a terror in the years 1918 to 1922 with its demonization of the kulaks and any other suspected class enemies. So arguably, Lenin is completely responsible for Stalinism and the horrors of Stalinism that took place in the 1930s, the mass purges and the millions of deaths through collectivization. On the other hand, Lenin didn't really turn against his own party like Stalin did. And arguably, therefore, Stalinism is much worse from Leninism and a departure from Leninism. We'll talk a little bit more about Stalin and how different it was from Leninism later. But when Lenin died, 1924, the question was, what would happen next and what would happen to the country? And those questions dominated Russian politics, Soviet politics, for the next 3 or 4 years until, in 1928, Stalin came to power. And I'll deal with that in the next film.